Should we have our doggies meet? Should I go grab Lucy and they can see each other? She watches TV for like half an hour. She just sits there and watches. She's
totally looking at the screen.
Yeah.
She's totally looking at the screen.
The thing that blows my mind is she will watch me just work on the computer, and she clearly is watching the mouse move around the screen. It's unbelievable.
She hasn't taken her eyes off the screen yet.
Yeah, that's why. She'll just do this the whole time.
No. You're so good. You're so smart.
Oh, that's cute. Nice dog.
Oh, she's the best.
Best dog ever.
This is the best dog.
Actually, no, Lulu, you're the best dog.
No, Lucy is the best dog. Lucy is the best dog.
Can I ask you a question?
Ask away.
This just came to me.
Mm-hmm.
Who do you think would win a fight between you and me? A physical fight, if we were both just going for it? Be honest.
Okay. I have two answers to this. Let's say we're in some situation that's like a boxing ring, right? Where there's a ref and we're having a fight under those circumstances.
Yeah.
Like if we were actually going to fight in real life,
yeah,
you would probably win.
Right.
However, I think if we were in a situation where we were having a legitimate fight to the death, I would put my money on me then in that case. If it's only one of us is coming out of this alive, I think I might overcome under those circumstances.
What's the difference before you tell me about the reason for your second answer? Because that's kind of what I meant, like, you know, just a raw fight, like a, you know, in the jungle. But why would I win a boxing match?
I don't mean like a boxing match. I just mean any kind of fight. Let's say it was a reward on Patreon that if we raise a certain amount of money, you and I will have a fight in a ring, right? We're not going to do that, people. Don't even start. But let's just say that that was a reward.
Never say never.
Yeah, maybe for shard money, I might consider it. But give me on pay-per-view.
We all have our price.
With a fight like that, though, there's a very different calculus going on, which is that there is some planned life after the fight. And so you have to make a calculation of when it is you want to concede that fight. So I think I would be much more likely to concede soon. A fight to the death is different because if you lose, there is nothing. And so any amount of physical harm to yourself is potentially worth it because otherwise you're dead.
You're more likely just to quit if you can. But if there's no quitting, then you're betting on you.
If there's no quitting, I'm betting on me.
But if there is quitting, you're a quitter.
That's not exactly the way I would phrase it, but if you want to phrase it that way, you can.
Why do you think you would win the fight to the death?
Under those circumstances, I might just be a crazy fighter, right? That I would have some sort of deep down reserve inside of me. And it would just be all out. It would, you know, there's no gentlemanly fighting here. It would just be whatever you could possibly do.
Yeah.
So I'm not guaranteeing that I would win. Just to be clear, I don't think that this is like obviously I would win. I'm just saying I would put my money on me if it was a fight to the death. But even still, I think we're relatively evenly matched. So it might be like a 60-40 me fight to the death and maybe a 70-30 you boxing match kind of fight.
Okay.
How do you feel about these numbers? What do you think about this?
Well, I was thinking about this on my drive home tonight.
Yeah.
And I decided pretty quickly and pretty easily that you would win.
I don't agree with that.
What do you mean you don't agree with it? You just said that's what you think too.
Well, again, if I laid out my two scenarios. I think I made this very clear. But why do you think I would win?
Well, you are bigger.
I'm taller than you. Yeah, that's true.
And you have. You seem to have quite big fists. I wouldn't want to get punched by one of your hands. But the main reason was kind of what you said. I think there's I think you have a big reservoir of anger you could call upon if you needed to.
Mm-hmm.
You could just go wild. But, yeah, and I was thinking, you know, cage fight to the death. Yeah, I think you'd just go a bit crazy. Like when you burned yourself with coffee, the Hulk would come out.
That would actually be my strategy to win. I would burn myself with coffee right before the fight.
No, I do. I think you would win. I think you would win a fight between us.
Hmm.
If it was something, if it was like sport, maybe not, because you'd just be like, meh. But if it was not necessarily to the death, but if it was like real anger at each other and just wanting to really hurt each other, I think you would do better. I like get angry for short periods and then I just like don't mind anymore. But I think you could just sustain sustain the aggression.
Well, I guess we'll never find out unless that Patreon thing comes through.
So we're back after quite a break.
Yeah, it feels like it has been forever since I've talked to you, man. It has been forever. I am 95% sure this is the biggest break. If not between us actually talking, for sure the biggest break between when the episodes are actually going to be published. I think this is our biggest break ever.
Yeah. So, and is this the, I think this is the first time we've recorded Hello Internet when you're not in London.
Yes, I think you are right. For the listeners, I'm in North Carolina at this moment. I was thinking we recorded the last episode in North Carolina, but that's not right at all. We recorded it just before we left, and I think I edited it in North Carolina.
You're confused. You're thinking of a podcast with your mistress.
I can't keep anything straight because I'm still very jet-lagged as well. That's also why I'm having a hard time remembering anything.
I thought that maybe when you called, you were going to put your parents on so I could speak to them because they're Brady fans, and I didn't get to see them.
Why would my parents answer my computer when you FaceTime?
No, I would have thought you'd say, "Oh, look, Brady, here's my parents. They want to say hello," and they would just lean in and say, "Hey, Brady, how you doing?"
No, we got work to do. We're starting. We've got stuff to do. this is not like a social call, but I'm all set up here in the home office in my house, and I don't have any understanding about why my parents would just be standing on either side of me waiting.
Do you think they would like to speak to me later if I called them? Or?
That might be awkward for everybody, but you can give it a shot.
Why? Who would it be awkward for?
Everybody. I think I just said that. I think it would be awkward for everybody. But
it
then
wouldn't
again,
be awkward for me.
That was literally what I was about to say, is I forget that you are very good with people, but my whole family is somewhat like me, if that gives you a little bit of a feeling about why it might be awkward for other people.
Really?
Yeah.
Maybe I shouldn't speak to them then. If they're like you, I should probably give them a wide berth.
We have even discussed while I was here how everyone in the whole family does the same, "Oh no, the person at Starbucks has recognized me, I can never go here again" thing. Everyone in my family does that exact same behavior. You can't go to a restaurant where the waiter knows precisely who you are.
Do your parents like move house every 3 months or something? Or?
No, but they can rotate the places that they're going to go.
I'll tell you what, Starbucks would never have become the business it became if the world was full of your family.
No, the business just shifts around. That's the way it works. You're still going to a Starbucks, just a different one.
All right. So you have been all over. You're in North Carolina. You went to Hawaii. You've just been on planes everywhere.
Yeah.
Anything I should know? Or?
Yeah, it has been quite the summer of traveling for me. I came to North Carolina for my family. I went to Hawaii for, I don't even know, 10 days, 12 days for my wife's family. And then recently I have come back to North Carolina. It has been a jet lag-tastic summer from my perspective. And now is the beginning of the eastward part of that, which is very rough and I don't like it all.
Well, you were supposed to come back like a week ago, but it sounds like you're just waiting around for some seat on a plane sometime. Like, what is this?
This is always the standby uncertainty of precisely when we're going to go, and I don't know when. I can't even speak, Brady. I can't even speak because I'm so out of my mind. But
it just seems like such a situation that you would not find acceptable. Like, I can't believe that you tolerate the situation where you have no control or say over when you're going to fly and you're just waiting around for a week for a maybe plane. I can't believe you tolerate this.
I think the only reason I tolerate it is because this is what flying has been for my whole life, that I almost never, ever have a dedicated ticket. And so I just feel like, oh, isn't this how everybody flies? That, you know, maybe you're leaving on someday, maybe you're not, and you don't even know. I think that's the only reason why still grown-up adult me seems perfectly fine with a situation where
that's
the dates
stupid.
Are flying
you know ridiculous. That's not the case. You're Mr. Rational, and of course you know that's not how everyone flies, and you've known this for years. Are you being cheap? Is that what it is?
I'm not saying that I don't literally know that people aren't all flying on standby. I think it's just that this is how I've always flown, and so it feels very natural.
As I said, are you being cheap?
I'm not being cheap.
You want the upgrade. You want
That's
the upgrade.
Exactly right. That's exactly right.
Gray, do you know what? Having the upgrade makes the flight nicer, uh-huh. but it's completely cancelled out by the fact you had to wait a week to get it.
You may be right about that, Brady. You may be right.
I don't think your kind of cost benefit analysis is working here. I think there's a bug in your machine here.
Yeah, I need to debug some of my code. I need to change this around.
It's so unlike you. Oh, I'll just sit around for a week, not knowing when I'm going to fly, because then when I eventually do the 6 or 7 hour flight, it will be more comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm.
I'm sorry that you disapprove of this. I'll see what I can do about it.
I went to Morocco again for a holiday, which seems like an eternity ago. I did at that point, I was trying to figure out if that was the furthest apart we've ever been since Aww. Starting the podcast. Like it was like, because you know how you say there's that rubber band between us and it really hurts you when we're far apart.
Do I say that?
Yeah, you've said something like that. I'm sure you've said something like that before.
Okay.
So I got out that website that does those, how do you say it? Antipodes, antipodes? How do you do it when you look at what's on the exact opposite side of the earth from where you are?
Earth sandwich. That's what that is.
Well, no, that's not the proper name for it. But anyway.
I'm pretty sure that is it. That's what it is.
Because I thought maybe we were going to be close. So I got out the website to check when you were in Hawaii and I was in Marrakesh.
Uh-huh.
Turns out we weren't really as far apart as I thought.
How far apart were we?
Well, I don't know. When the hole through the earth came out nowhere near each other.
But when you are in Marrakesh and I am in Hawaii, we are just about as far apart as we can be time zone wise. It's almost impossible for us to be further apart.
Well, let me call it up.
I think we're like one time zone away from being as far away as possible.
So when you're in Hawaii, if you were to dig your tunnel, it looks like you come out roughly in Botswana, like right south of Africa.
No, thank you.
I was right up in the north of Africa. And if you dug a hole from where I was, you'd be coming out right near New Zealand.
New Zealand's kind of close to Hawaii.
Yeah, not that close.
You have to take what you can get in the Pacific Ocean.
Yeah.
This vast stretch of nothingness.
I'm going to have a look if you dug a tunnel from Adelaide, home of the Black Stump.
Oh, always with the Adelaide.
You come out pretty much right in the middle of the Atlantic.
Uh-huh.
I love this thing, these antipodes or antipodes or however you say it. I'm fascinated by it.
There's a map that shows the overlap. It's surprisingly little of the Earth that actually does overlap itself. Again, because if you actually look at a real globe and rotate it so that Hawaii is in the center of your globe, all the way the rest of the way around that globe is just water. It's like if you look right at Hawaii, there is just nothing. So it's like on half of the earth, practically, there is no land except for tiny specks of islands. So I think that's part of the reason why there's so very little overlap if you're trying to think about digging a hole through the center of the earth.
No, I'm looking at that map now. It's very interesting. Very interesting. Do you know the day I arrived at Marrakesh, it was 55 degrees Celsius in Marrakesh.
That sounds hot, but I need to do the calculation for that. In terms of real temperatures. So 55 in your made up nonsense temperature measuring is
super hot.
Holy cow.
What is it in Fahrenheit? Like 10 million or something?
Yeah, it's 131 degrees Fahrenheit. Wow.
I wasn't actually staying in Marrakesh. I was staying in the mountains, Atlas Mountains, just above Marrakesh. And it was cooler there, but it was still in the 40s every day.
Okay, so 40...
Like 42, 43 was very common.
Okay, that's still pretty hot. That's 107, 108 degrees.
There you go.
That is very hot. How are you surviving such temperatures, Brady?
Cold drinks.
Cold drinks?
Air conditioning.
Oh, air conditioning. Okay.
Yeah. Oh, it was, I wasn't hiking up a mountain. I was doing luxury.
Yeah, you were doing luxury? Did you have Sherpas? Were there Sherpas?
No, there were no Sherpas, but they were very helpful people bringing me cool drinks.
I saw some of those cool drinks when you posted them on Twitter. Mm. And then moments later, I got a message from your wife telling me to tell you to get off your phone.
Yeah.
I wasn't quite sure how to handle that.
Well, she was on her phone to contact you. So
obviously, she had to be on her phone to contact me. But it did feel a little bit like I was suddenly in the middle of something. And I was
she was encouraging me. Like, you know, that night when I was sending you all those naughty pictures, she was encouraging me.
Okay, can we just for the listeners, we need to just establish right away what you're talking about before
people's... This is the Brady definition of naughty, yeah. Not the Gray definition of naughty.
Before people's imaginations start running wild.
I think that ship has sailed.
Because as I did tell your wife that you and I were busy sharing naughty pictures with each other. And that's why we were on our phones on opposite sides of the world. You started this, I want to be clear, of sending me... I don't even know how to describe this. Pictures that were of innocuous objects, but that were somehow still suggestive pictures, maybe. I don't know why you started doing this, but you just messaged me some out of the blue. I don't know why, but you wanted to send me those naughty pictures.
Sometimes you've just got to be naughty. Can I just say as well, though, I'm going to say something, but I've put a pause so you can edit it out if you need to. Speaking of naughtiness, who was it who, after the last podcast, immediately sent me a text message saying, I just did that whole podcast not wearing any pants?
But I was, that's not naughty. I was at home. And I was still wearing boxers.
Well, you say you were. I don't know. On the subject of naughty, I know there was this joke last episode about how we're going to make it like a really bad swear word and, you know, you censored it and things like that. And everyone's really run with this joke. And I'm all for running with a joke, as you know. There is a bit of a problem here that I don't think people are thinking about. And I'm sure me pointing it out isn't going to do anything for it, but I'm going to point it out anyway. People really should stop saying things like on Facebook and Twitter and that along the lines of, Brady, I can't believe you used the N-word.
Right.
Because if someone reads that and doesn't then do a massive investigation into the history of Hello Internet, they're going to assume that I have used the actual bad N-word somewhere on the internet and I'm being reprimanded by it about it. And if they don't figure out what the joke is, they're going to think, gosh, what a bad guy using that word. Right. A word I obviously would never use. So... just think about that when you make jokes about the N-word. Third parties might take it the wrong way. And come on, we're all friends here.
Yes. I have seen people making jokes about censoring out naughty. And I think the appropriate way to do it is when people put asterisks in the middle, but they still leave the Y. They don't just do N asterisk, asterisk, asterisk. They do N with the asterisk and the Y, so you can at least vaguely try to figure out what it is, and more importantly, realize what it's not.
Wouldn't it be funnier if you just like asterisked one letter? So you put like N asterisk UGHTY. So it was like the worst censoring ever. I can't believe you said naughty.
This episode of Hello Internet is brought to you by Hover. Hover is the best way to buy and manage domain names. When you get a great idea for something that you want to do on the internet, you need to get the right domain name. And Hover gives you exactly what you need to do that. They have easy-to-use tools to buy and manage your domain name so you know exactly what you're doing. In less than 5 minutes, you can find the domain you want and get it up and running. All you have to do is search for a few keywords, and Hover will show you the best available options across all the domain name extensions out there. So they do the big ones, of course, .com, .net, but also all the crazy little ones like .diamonds. The website is clean and simple to use, so you don't have to mess around with a complicated service. And most other domain name registrars are willfully complicated, intentionally complicated, so that you don't know what you're doing. So if you already have a domain name that is trapped at one of those registrars, Hover has a valet transfer service that will help you get that domain name out. They'll just do everything for you. They're professionals. They'll save your domain from wherever you happen to have it registered. Now, Hover does have an offer for new people signing up with their service for Hello Internet listeners, and Brady took the opportunity while I was on vacation and not looking at my email to arrange with Hover this week's offer code that he knew that I would have to be saying. And this week's offer code is naughty. So if you go to hover.com and you use the offer code naughty, you will get 10% off your first purchase at Hover. They're simple. They're easy to use. I can't count how many domain names I have registered there. They are a great company, and we appreciate them sponsoring Hello Internet. If you have ever wanted to buy a domain name, now is the time to do it, so we can all show Hover just how naughty Hello Internet listeners are.
There's so much follow-up and so much to talk about, Gray.
We have a million just random things that we have added over the past couple weeks to our show notes.
I got a really interesting email here. Mm-hmm. This is a really quick one. I've got an interesting email. I've printed out all my emails on paper today because I thought that would make my job easier.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't. It's just caused a big mountain of paper that's confusing me. This comes from... Oh, I hate it when I say this comes from before I know what the name's going to be. And then I look at the name and it's something I just have no chance of pronouncing.
See, this is why this just say something like, we got an email about, and then you don't even try to say the person's name because you're always going to lose that game.
I feel like if you say the name, though, it's not only is it nice for the person, but it encourages more people because they think, oh, I could have my name said on Hello Internet. I could have my name mispronounced by Brady. This comes from Gautam. Gautam? I should be able to say that because I think that's the same name as an Indian cricketer called Gautam Gambhir. But anyway, that's who it comes from.
The cricketer?
Not the cricketer.
Oh. No.
Well, maybe it is the cricketer. He doesn't say he's not the cricketer.
I'm going to assume it's the cricketer.
Okay, this comes from a very good test cricketer for India called Gautam Gambhir, or someone else called Gautam maybe.
Mm-hmm.
I thought it might interest you to know that you can buy the ink registrars use from the manufacturer. I talked about how registrar's ink was like fairy's blood or something that no one could get except registrars. Seems that's not the case. It's a type of ink called iron gall, I'm guessing, which is made as a suspension of tiny iron particles in dilute acid. And apparently this has been used since the 5th century. Most old manuscripts have it. And the reason it's good, obviously, is that the iron particles don't fade under exposure from UV light like normal inks. So it sounds like it wasn't just the sort of forensic nature of the ink that makes it useful to registrars, but it's also its long-lastingness.
I wonder if that's what archive ink uses as well. Just regular old archive ink. Iron.
Quite possibly. There you go. So thank you for that. I'm going to piece of paper there. Don't you love that sound?
I have to say, I do like the sound of you handling the physical paper. That's much nicer than clicky keyboard sounds for, Brady's like in a real newsroom looking at pieces of paper that he's sorting through and you can hear the shuffling. Yeah. I like that.
You need to hear typewriters in the background and copy, stop the presses. Actually, Gray, let's stop the presses because we've forgotten something that I would like to do on every podcast from now on.
I'm not sure I'm going to allow it, but just go ahead.
I would like to check where our listener, John, who plays the bass on a boat, is today. I'm gonna call up my marine traffic app.
Okay.
And I'm gonna call up my fleets because I've put his ship into my fleet. His ship, which is called the Anthem of the Seas, and he is currently rather disappointingly docked in Parma. Wasn't he in Parma last time?
I think he was.
The ship is docked in Parma. Anyway.
How anticlimactic that was.
How anticlimactic. But I always just want to know where he is. But I have another nice email here, Gray. Pulls out the paper.
Very good. Yes, we can hear that.
This comes from... Oh, dear. It's another one. This comes from Gannon, which is an unusual name. Hi, Brady. And Gray, I guess, but he won't read this. Wink. You are correct. He won't read this, but he is having it read to him.
I'm listening to it at this very moment.
Now, I like to think we have a diverse audience, Gray, but I'm beginning to think maybe we don't. I'm beginning to think everyone who listens to our podcast is either called Tim or is a bass player on a boat because Gannon here says, I am also a professional bass player working on a cruise ship.
I'm not sure I believe this story.
he's got a lot of details here. In fact, I work for the same company that was mentioned by the person from Anthem. I work primarily as a trombonist in the orchestra on the beautiful Majesty of the Seas. And I sometimes play bass for the jazz sets. He's a seasonal musician, and during the school year, he's actually a music professor at a university in Central Texas. But when he was writing from the capital of the Bahamas, which is... You know what that is?
I do not know what that is.
I would have thought you would. You seem like someone who would know lots of capitals. Nassau?
No, I wasn't going to get that.
There's a pirate-themed bar here on the ship I assume he's talking about, and all the crew like to go because they have good Wi-Fi. Love the podcast. Been listening since episode 2 was released. Keep up the good work. So, you know what I'm going to do now, don't you, Greg?
I do know what you're going to do. Where is he?
Let's call up the Majesty of the Seas, which is also in my fleets now. And that is, rather more excitingly, that looks like it's sailing. And it is currently sailing near the Bahamas, basically about halfway between the Bahamas and Miami.
Oh, there we go.
So enjoy your cruise there, Gannon, and any other bass players on ships who care to get in touch.
No, you see, know where to... you can't do that, Brady, because all you're going to do is just get an endless number of emails from people pretending to be bass players on ships.
I don't think that will happen. I think our listeners are definitely naughty, and they are and they are a nuisance. But I don't think they are liars.
Our listeners are no nuisance whatsoever.
No, like that. No, that they will, like, if given the chance, they will create nuisance. They are mischievous. Maybe is a better word. They are mischievous, but I don't think they're liars. So I don't think they will say they're bassists on a ship if they're not.
I'm just thinking out loud here, Brady, but I've been seeing a lot of feedback as well from people talking about their jobs and what they listen to when they're on the podcast. And I'm thinking we're getting enough of this feedback that very soon we need to institute a photographic proof policy.
Oh, yes.
What the person's actually doing. So all of these surgeons who are apparently listening to Hello Internet while commenting on the Reddit, you know, I need to see a picture of your iPhone in the chest cavity of somebody that you're operating on with Hello Internet on the screen. Because otherwise, it's just like every surgeon in America is listening to our podcast while doing their work. And I'm beginning to be a bit doubtful about how many of you really, really there are.
Well, Gray, this sounds like the perfect opportunity to introduce my new favorite corner of Hello Internet. And this is People's Occupation Corner. What people do and what they do while listening to Hello Internet. Bing, bong, bing.
Oh, Brady, it's got to be Career Corner. Career Corner.
No, no, because it doesn't have, it's not necessarily your career. You could be, you know, you could be a knitter. You could be, you know, I work in a phone center, but you knit at night, and that's when you listen to Hello Internet, and it's the knitting I want to hear about. So I want to know what people do while they're listening to the show. That means more to me than what their job is.
That's fair enough. Yeah. But I don't think your name was very catchy. We need a catchy name for this.
No, The joke is that it has an uncatchy name, something like What People Do While Listening to Hello Internet Corner. The joke is it's a cumbersome name. Work with me, Gray. Trust me.
Is that the joke? Is that the funny part of this?
Gray, which one of us has pedigree here making up names for things that stick?
That hurts, Brady. That hurts deep.
But more on that later.
Okay, if you want to call this what it is that people happen to do while they are listening to the Hello Internet Podcast Corner, I'm on board.
See, that's beautiful. It should have a slightly different name every time as well, so good for you. Okay. I'm gonna give you a few here. Now, I'm going to pre-warn you here, Gray.
Yeah.
Some of these are amazing.
Is that a warning? That's not a warning.
Are you wearing like a hat or something? Because I am worried that these are going to be so amazing that your brain could explode out of your head.
Oh, I have the coolest hat that I've been wearing that I got for Hawaii. I have like an Indiana Jones style hat that I can wear.
Put it on, Gray. Put it on, because I don't want your brain splattered all over your screen. Okay. Literally, it would be gray matter on your screen. Because this is some of these are amazing. I'm gonna ease you into it.
I feel like you're doing movie spoilers here, Brady. You're building it up so much, I can't possibly.
No. Listen to me.
I'm listening to you.
Listen to me. I know you're worried. I know you're worried. I'm building it up too much, and I can't possibly meet expectations. But trust me. At the end, you will be impressed.
Okay. You are in a funny mood today, Brady. I think it's because it's so late at night when we're recording this for you. But let's go.
I've had an odd day. This is from Carlo. Brady and Gray, thanks for all your content, etc., etc. And he says, I think Brady's videos are better than Gray's, but he doesn't actually say that. He says, I listen to the podcast mainly during my work as a penetration tester.
That sounds, frankly, that sounds naughty.
It does a bit. Do you know what a penetration tester is?
You probably don't want me to guess what that might be.
Well, come on, have a guess.
Okay, my guess is he's working in a materials lab.
That is a good guess, Gray. That is a good guess, and that's what I would have guessed too. That's what I thought when I first saw it. Turns out it's not the case.
Okay.
It's actually a job that would really appeal to you.
Oh, yeah?
The email continues. Don't let the title fool you. The job mainly involves breaking into financial and medical institutions through social engineering and working towards compromise of their network in the same way a real hacker or attacker would.
Hmm. So he's a white hat hacker.
Yeah, I guess he is. Cool job, eh?
I imagine that is quite a satisfying and rewarding job for the sort of person who would go into it. You know, you have permission to try to break into people's security systems. I bet that's super fun for the people who like doing that kind of thing.
I bet Carlo could tell you some cool stories over a beer as well.
Mm. Especially the social engineering point. You know, as always, humans are the weak link in your security. That they're always the ones to go after.
Just a quick one here. This is from Patrick. Hi, my name is Patrick. I wanted to tell you, brackets and Gray, that I listen to Hello Internet when I do surgery on mice. Surgery on mice. I work as a research assistant and I study the effect of probiotic bacteria on the heart. When I do repetitive tasks, your podcast is my favorite thing to listen to. Tell Gray that if he is paying his tax in the US still, he's helping to fund my research. And thank you for the wonderful podcast.
I actually have seen photographic proof of this one. This came up on the Reddit once, someone showing the actual Hello Internet podcast player and mouse surgery simultaneously. So I'm presuming it's the same guy, unless we have multiple mouse surgeons listening to the podcast.
Gray, if we have multiple bass players on cruise ships, I think it's almost inevitable we have multiple mouse surgeons.
Now I want to know if it's the same guy or if we have many mouse surgeons, many much mouse surgeons. Yeah.
You never know.
You do never know.
Here we go. This is a very long email, so I'm not going to read it all. Okay. But it was a very good email. I enjoyed it all. Thank you very much to Jamie.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to inform you of another career, etc., etc. I'm the sound guy on a travel documentary TV show. My day consists of recording clean audio in some very exotic and beautiful places. In summary, he listens to the podcast in his headphones in his downtime between recording because there's so much downtime on a documentary.
Mm-hmm.
And he has it rigged up so that his phone goes into the same headphones that he records through, and he just turns it off when they have to do proper work.
Mm-hmm.
His email continues. Although this became a problem a few days ago when I was taken by surprise that the crew started to film an interview, I had no time to unzip my bag and turn off my phone, and I had to start recording immediately. So for the entire length of the interview, I was not only listening to a local Chinese man tell us all about his life, but also Brady talking about the ridiculous Brag Humble.
How frustrating that must have been.
I know. That Chinese guy must have been interrupting some fascinating stuff from me.
What I like about this one is that we are basically interrupting and causing problems at somebody's work.
Oh, yeah. I'll tell you what, though. The Brag Humble. I could talk about that more.
You know, but let's not.
You're going to like this one. You're going to like this one. You ready? This is from Miguel. And there is proof to go with this.
Okay.
It still could be fake, but there was enough proof for me to believe it's real. And that's why I'm reading it out. Don't think I'm just reading out everything that comes in. Okay. I was sent proof for this.
Okay.
Miguel. Just a quick one. I thought I'd write in to let you know I'm a VFX compositing artist in London, currently working on the new Star Wars film at Industrial Light and Magic. Obviously can't reveal any information about the project, but just chipping in a listener job corner, as I thought you and CGP might like to know there are some shots in the upcoming film that were created while listening to Hello Internet.
Oh, wow.
Pretty good.
That is pretty good, I have to say.
Yeah.
You said that there's some proof on this, though, yeah?
There is proof, yeah.
You have seen something that confirms to you that this is definitely the case?
I haven't seen absolute total 100% proof, but I've seen enough that makes me think if he's lying, he's gone to a lot of trouble.
Okay.
He's gone to so much trouble that he almost deserves to have his name read out anyway. So
right.
I believe him.
I will take your word for it.
Okay.
I'm just saying, absolute proof, that would be really amazing is in the background of Star Wars somewhere, seeing a tiny Hello Internet logo. You know, just there's a lot of stuff in the background of those movies.
Hopefully not as much as the background as in the prequels, but yeah. All right.
That's pretty good.
Miguel, if you do manage to drop the Hello Internet logo anywhere into the new Star Wars film, you will have our undying gratitude.
Yeah, I was going to say, it will be the most amazing thing that has ever happened.
Do you know the... I had the 60 symbols symbol in an actual published X-Men comic.
Really?
Yeah, I've got it here on my shelf. There's an X-Men, and in it, they're looking at the screen, mm-hmm. Like a YouTube screen. They're watching mm-hmm. a video, and there's like other recommended channels on the side, and whoever the mm-hmm. artist was obviously a 60 Symbols fan, and they include a tiny little 60 Symbols logo there.
That is pretty cool, Brady.
That's pretty cool.
Pretty cool.
Okay, here's another one. This is... There was a series of emails here, so I'm not going to go into all of them.
Mm-hmm.
But Derek, who lives in New York City and seems to be a skydiver cameraman, mm-hmm. so he does lots and lots of skydiving.
I'm amazed you didn't mess up that name, but yes, go on.
That would be so unfair to call him Derek in his one moment on the podcast. So, so he listens to Hello Internet a lot by the sounds of it. He listens mm-hmm. to it when he's packing his parachute. He listens to it on the flight up. And apparently he also then listens to it on the skydive. He listens to Hello Internet while free-falling.
What?
Just to be clear, he's not deliberately listening to Hello Internet on the free-fall. Let me read a bit of this to you. The upshot is he listens to it on the flight up because it's all, you know, it's time to kill while you're just sitting in the plane.
Right.
And by the time they're all kitted up and they're doing everything, it would be more trouble to unzip everything and take his headphones, his earbuds out and stuff and jump than it is uh-huh. just to leave it running. So he's not listening to it because he wants to listen to it on the skydive. Uh-huh. That's just incidental. But he does listen to Hello Internet while skydiving. And I did say to him, can you hear it while you're free-falling?
This is what I'm wondering.
Yeah. Well, apparently you can, but he did say something interesting. I can hear your voice, as in Brady, more than Gray's.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why that is. There's something about my voice that's more easy to hear when skydiving.
Your voice is at the right frequency, I guess.
I came in as a fan of Gray, but I've become a Braidite. He says, I also kind of want to call you a jerk, just so that you could tell Gray I was naughty if it comes up. In fact, now that he's called me a jerk, I am going to call him Dirk. There we go. So there we go. Thank you very much, Dirk, the skydiver.
Derek, the skydiver.
You're even correcting that one. Okay, Gray. Are you ready? Are you ready for the big one?
Okay.
Here we go. I'm going to send you the picture.
Okay.
You got your thingamajig?
I'll open up iMessage.
This comes from Chris.
Okay.
There's an email. There are numerous pictures.
Okay.
This is one of them.
You make me nervous when you do things like this, Brady. I don't know why.
Here comes the picture, Gray.
Okay. Okay.
Do you want to tell the listeners what you're looking at?
Am I looking at Air Force One?
You are.
Okay. I'm looking at someone holding up their iPhone playing Hello Internet in front of Air Force One. And they, I'm guessing, are military personnel because I can see a little bit of the uniform on their arm. So
right.
It looks like someone who's going to get on Air Force One.
Let me tell you about this email from Chris.
Okay.
Now, this email has so many qualifications in it. I just want to say, I'm not going to read them all,
uh-huh.
but Chris could not have made it any clearer
uh-huh.
that he only listens to Hello Internet at appropriate times during downtime when he is allowed to.
Right,
he is not listening to Hello Internet when he is doing things that are mission critical or when he shouldn't.
Of course, of course.
Okay. Now, he's made that very clear, and Chris sounds like a very, very responsible man.
Okay, got it.
Sir, he starts with sir. I like him already. I'll start by getting to it. In regards to jobs while listening to the Hello Internet section, I feel I should contribute. I directly work supporting Air Force One missions for the Air Force. I obviously can't listen during operations, etc., etc., etc. Special Air Missions Passenger Service, or SAMPACS. Not only do I get to be involved in operations when the president flies in or out, but sometimes I actually am the guy driving the staircase truck that he climbs to get onto Air Force One.
Very cool.
So the guy that drives the president's stairs up to Air Force One listens to Hello Internet. I assume he's not listening as he drives the stairs up to the plane, but of course.
That's amazing.
There you go. I thought this was a perfect storm. It involves planes, it involves the podcast, it involves the president of the United States. So what more could you want?
That's great. I guess that I am assuming that's his staircase car on the right-hand side of the picture there.
It is. He has said we are allowed to use that picture of holding the podcast up in front of the plane. He sent some other ones, which we are not to use.
Okay.
And he also sent lots of like press photos that shows like various dignitaries getting off the plane with him in the background, princes and princesses, the president. He sent me a picture of him and the president himself.
Very cool.
He says movement of the president is considered one of the very few no-fail missions at the Air Force.
Mm.
It's strictly business. So he's not listening to Hello Internet those times, of course.
No, of course not. Of course not. That's pretty good. Air Force One.
Are you impressed? Did I meet your expectations?
I am very impressed, Brady.
All right.
Did you solicit a whole bunch of emails asking for
no,
feedback?
No, I don't think so. These
are just the messages that people sent to you?
And there are loads of other ones. I have been reading them all. I've even saved a few good ones for next time. And you feel free to keep trying to send them in. Don't bother sending them to Gray, of course, because, well, you all know why.
We do all know why. But
yep.
Brady likes getting these messages. I love hearing about them. And I'm glad that you have a few ready for the next installment of stuff that people happen to do while they're listening to our show corner.
So I'd like to talk to you about one of today's sponsors, and that's Backblaze. Now, I'm sure you've heard Gray's take on this, and let's be honest, he's a little bit alarmist sometimes, isn't he? Backblaze is a service that will back up everything on your computer, constantly whirring away in the background and saving all your precious zeros and ones to an off-site server. Now, Gray's told you many times that when catastrophe strikes, and it almost certainly will, Backblaze will be your savior because all your data is safe and secure off-site. Now, this is true. I cannot argue with this, and it's the main reason I use Backblaze myself. Protection and peace of mind. But I don't want you to think of Backblaze as just like Batman, a silent guardian, a watchful protector. Today, I'd like you to think of Backblaze as kind of like the best friend you could have in the world. Let's call him Davo. Now, let me explain by telling you about three of Backblaze's services. First, they send you occasional emails updating you on how your data is doing, how much is stored. Maybe they'll warn you if they haven't heard from your computer in a while. Second, they've got a really cool app, and you can use this to access any single file stored on their servers. Well, your files, you can't access other people's files, but you can access any of your files stored on their servers. What a handy thing to be able to get into your files from your device remotely. Now, thirdly, they can send you all your data on physical drives, which is really handy if you haven't really got the time or the bandwidth to re-download everything. Now, those are three pretty handy things. Let's get back to Davo, right? Imagine all your most important photos and documents, like physical ones, are stored in cardboard boxes at a friend's house, Davo's house. Now, that's all well and good and you have peace of mind, but imagine this. Imagine if once a month, Davo went up into his loft, checked all your boxes, and then sent you a text message just letting you know everything was okay. That'd be good, wouldn't it? Also imagine Davo gave you a spare key, so that if you ever wanted just to come and grab one or two things from the boxes, you could do it whether he was home or not. And lastly, imagine if you wanted all your boxes back and Davo said, no worries, pop them in the back of his car and personally drove them around to your house. What a friend Davo would be. And that is basically what Backblaze is doing with your data. Much more of a buddy than Batman, but sort of kind of both. I bet Gray loved that analogy. Now, if you'd like to join Backblaze, and you really should consider it, whether you're scared or because you just think they sound nice, I can't recommend them highly enough. It costs just $5 a month. It's totally worth it. Here's what to do. Go to backblaze.com/hellointernet so they know you came from here on the podcast. And if you want to try before you buy, there's a risk-free, no credit card trial.
I think you'll be impressed. That address again is backblaze.com/hallointernet.
Oh, here's something interesting.
Yeah.
Now, look, I know you're going to be a bit reluctant to do this. And
you saying that literally made my whole body clench up with resistance before I've even heard what it is.
And I also don't want to set a precedent. So this isn't going to work a second time.
This is not...
But because this is the first one of these I've got, I'm going to give it the benefit of the doubt and try my luck with Gray.
Okay.
All right. Here we go. It says, "Hello, Brady. This message is intended for Gray." That's normally the point at which I delete emails. But
I'm so sorry you get all these, Brady, but it's also hilarious to me.
Seriously, I usually don't read on, but it had an interesting subject line and it was a very short email, so I did read on.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, gosh, I'm going to struggle with this. I have lexical gustatory synesthesia.
Mm-hmm.
The way Gray says composed, as in the word composed.
Composed.
Yes. Apparently you saying that tastes like very good raspberry yogurt or yogurt, depending on how you like to say yogurt or yogurt.
Uh-huh.
All the words with pose in them taste like raspberry yogurt, but the way Gray pronounces it tastes extra good. Here are 10 other words that I would like to taste Gray saying.
Okay, but before you go any further, can we just explain to the listeners who are not aware what synesthesia is? Because I think otherwise this is very confusing.
Well, hopefully they're all number 5 viewers and they've seen some of my synesthesia videos. So we shouldn't have to, but just in case they haven't.
That's true. That's true. We can assume that everybody who listens to the show has watched every one of your number 5 videos.
Yes.
But on the off chance that they have not. Synesthesia is a condition where your senses are cross-connected in unexpected ways. So that the usual example that is given is that when people look at numbers, those numbers are colored or they perceive colors every time. So 7 is very yellow or 3 is very pink. And there are also cross-connections like this person seems to have, which are tastes or smells that go along with sounds. So this person has the taste version of this, which is crossed with sound. So when they hear particular sounds, they also experience tastes. Brains are funny.
So when Gray says
composed,
our listener is tasting raspberry yogurt.
Right.
So they've got just 10 words here that they would like you to say. They haven't said what these words will taste like. So I'm hoping they will then email me again and tell me what they taste like after you've said them. Huh.
Well, the person very likely doesn't know what the words will taste like.
Well, we're about to find out. But the interesting thing is, and the only reason I'm doing this, is because the 10th word, they think my version will taste better than yours.
This feels like a very strange thing we're about to do.
So there's 9 words they want to taste from you, and the 10th word, they want to taste from me. But they're going to get both of us anyway on all the words.
Okay.
Are you ready, Gray?
Yeah. All the gustatory synesthetics out there, get ready.
get your knives and forks out. You're in for a treat.
Or in for something horrible, depending on how your brain is wired.
Are you ready?
Uh-huh.
Because.
Because?
You've got to say it in more like sexy Gray voice, you know. Like say it all like, you know what I mean. Give it the treatment. You ready? Because.
Because.
Welcome.
Welcome.
Before.
Before.
Like.
Like.
Integral.
Integral.
Possibility.
Possibility.
Oh, I liked that. Even I liked that one.
What did that taste like, Brady?
I don't know. It was just so full of possibility the way you said it. Waiting.
Waiting.
Family.
Family.
Passion.
This is getting weird, Brady. Passion.
And here's the last one, and apparently this is the one that will sound better coming from me.
Mm-hmm.
Party.
Party. I can see why that would taste better if you say it.
Really? Why?
It sounds nicer when you say it.
Huh.
The words sound very different when you say them versus when I say them. Mm. But I think we need to also ask this person what naughty sounds like when you say it versus when I say it. Because that's, you say that word completely differently from me. You put such a spin on that word as to make everybody who hears you say it uncomfortable.
Well, I don't think that's true, but I also say it in different ways depending on the type of naughtiness I'm referring to.
Right, but even just the way you said it right then, there's always this little Brady twist on it.
Gray, I think that's in your mind.
It's not in my mind. It's in your voice. And we're going to need to have a content warning for all the naughtiness in this episode.
You're not going to censor it out again, I hope.
I think there's just too much this time around.
There's just too much naughtiness.
Yeah, maybe I'll censor it the first time as a joke, but I'm not sure I can keep it up for the whole episode because that was actually a lot of work the last 10 minutes of our previous show. When I didn't need any extra work, there was a whole lot of it.
You know what? I haven't even looked at our notes yet for follow-up. This has just been me going through bits of paper and my...
We just plunged into this.
Yeah.
Without even...
How long
without
have we
even
been
thinking about it.
Wow, we've been going a long time.
We've been going a long time. There's something I want to mention. Oh, sorry. There's something I want to mention very quickly.
Okay, it's been an hour. You can finally mention something. Go on. Every hour you can have one.
Great, thank you. And I would have totally forgotten this had it not been for the earlier person who wrote in. But the thing that I want to mention before I forget it is that many shows ago, I said that I had been developing this theory about Derek of Veritasium. Mm-hmm. And that theory was, in addition to being disease vector Derek, who travels around and spreads disease everywhere he goes, when he made me sick that one time I met him up in London, I also have this feeling that Derek's fundamental nature is somewhat quantum, in that you ended up meeting up with him in New York, was it? Where it just...
No, it was Boston and then New York.
It was Boston and then New York, where... You just discovered, you attempted to observe Derek, basically, and determined that he was in the hotel where you were staying, unbeknownst to either of you. And this happened a couple of times. And sure enough, I fly to the other side of the earth, to Hawaii, and where is Derek? But he is on the exact same island, the exact same side as me. And I just thought, this is further proof of Derek's quantum nature. Everywhere you go, Derek is potentially there. So Derek and I had a little meetup when we were in Hawaii, and it was great to see him. Evidence for quantum Derek observed in Hawaii.
The Dirk particle.
Yes, the Dirk particle. The Derek particle. Yep. Oh, he made me even do it.
The D particle.
The Derek particle.
Derek particle. Derek particle. It is everywhere.
Yes, that's right. Everywhere you attempt to observe it, there it is.
That's actually, Derek's actually the next thing they're looking for at the Large Hadron Collider. Now they've increased their power. Now the Higgs boson's taken care of. They want to nail down exactly where Derek is using that.
Exactly.
So I had a really interesting interaction. When I flew back from Morocco, I was waiting for my luggage to come off the plane. And a young man came up to me with his phone and with a pretty posh set of headphones and said, "You're Brady, aren't you?" And I'm like, "Yes." And he goes, "I was just listening to Hello Internet on that flight and I thought I saw you." So his name was Jake. And he listened to Hello Internet. Not only did he listen to Hello Internet on a plane, he listened to Hello Internet on a plane with me.
Wow.
With one half of the podcast. And I don't think that will ever be beaten, because the only way you could beat that would be to listen to Hello Internet on a plane with both of us. And we're actually contractually not allowed to fly on the same plane.
Oh, yeah?
Because it's like how the royal family's not allowed to put too many people in line to the throne on one flight. Because if the worst happens, like, Hello Internet would just be wiped out in one plane crash. So there always has to be one of us not on the plane. So
I have to tell you something, Brady. You and your plane crash corners. So I took all these flights. Every single flight I was on, I had the exact same thought, which is that if I die, somehow I'm going to end up on some version of plane crash corner that you do. Because if I die, right, there needs to be some message that, like, oh, the Hello Internet podcast is over. And it's like, oh, I'm going to be going down on an airplane, and my last thought is Brady's going to be doing a plane crash corner on Numberphile, mentioning that CGP Grey has died. This whole plane crash corner thing, I think about it now, end my own mortality every time I'm on a plane, every plane ride.
Grey.
I don't like this. Yeah?
If you die in a plane crash,
mm-hmm.
I will not be doing a plane crash corner about it.
Yeah? You sure?
You can know that right now.
Oh, yes. Yeah? It wouldn't be extremely tempting?
No.
You're going to watch Air Crash Investigator for the flight that
no.
I was on?
You think some good friend of mine dies in a plane crash and I'm going to exploit it and make like a plane crash corner about it?
There's
That's
gonna,
crazy.
There's going to be a plane crash corner on Brady stuff for CGP Grey's plane. That's all I could think of a few times.
Okay, well, if you think about that, that's fine. But just know that won't happen.
Oh, yeah?
Just let your last thoughts, just before the plane smashes into the ocean, just know that won't happen. Okay?
Oh, yeah?
Huh.
Okay. Okay. I swear, this podcast has made flying more difficult.
I find it funny, though, that your fear isn't, oh, no, I'm going to die, and what's going to happen to me after death, or is it going to hurt? Your fear is, what's Brady going to do with this on the internet?
I'm not saying that that's my fear or anything, but it was just a thought that I couldn't help think on every flight that I took this summer, and there have been many flights.
There's still another one, Gray.
Yes, there is still one more. Actually, there's still at least two more. I get to pass through Dulles for, let's see, like the sixth time in this summer. Yeah.
Wow.
I think this will be the sixth time I get to go to Dulles this summer. Not looking
forward
to it.
Do you want to give us Dulles Airport Corner? What's the latest happening there? Chewbacca, you take over from here.
I will just briefly say that I hate this airport. And we're flying to my parents, going through Dulles, and we have to spend some time in this horrible airport that, again, is just every section of it alternates from freezing cold to 85 degrees and 80% humidity. Like, they managed to recreate a tropical jungle on the inside. And I'm looking at the disgusting carpet and the low ceilings and just thinking, like, God, I hate this place. So we spent some time in Dulles. I'm like, great, I'm going to leave this airport. We're just going, right? But no, Dulles always gets you. And so we're flying out of Dulles, flying down to North Carolina. And there's a huge storm, apparently, in North Carolina that we're trying to fly around. And so there's like, Ooh. We're in this big, like, turbulent aircraft. I'm already feeling not very well. And now we have turbulence. And once again, thinking of the podcast, the pilot comes on after we've been flying for maybe 2 hours. And he's like, hey, everybody, we're running out of fuel, attempting to land in North Carolina because of this storm.
So I'm just going to radio Brady so he can get recording on his next plane crash corner. Yeah.
And again, as always with this stuff, I'm thinking, why are you telling me that we're running out of fuel? Well, I don't need to, whatever your next sentence is going to be, you could have skipped the we're running out of fuel part of the first sentence. But anyway,
he could have gone straight to we're going to crash.
Well, almost as bad. He says, we have to turn around and go back to Dulles. I would have almost rather attempted a crash landing in North Carolina than hear that we have to turn around and go back to Dulles.
Just smash it into a mountain. We'll take our chances.
Yeah. But this is why. Like, why do you tell me we're running out of fuel and then that we're going back the way that we've just come because there's apparently nowhere else to land on the eastern seaboard except Dulles? Yeah, so we turn around, we fly back to Dulles, we get there, I don't know, at like 2 a.m. or some ungodly hour, and I'm thinking, Dulles, right, it always gets you. So then we have to go to an airport, sorry, then we had to go to a hotel, and then come back to Dulles again the next day to fly out. It's just like, man, I do not like this airport, and it makes me pass through it even more than I normally should. But yeah, when they said we're flying back to Dulles, I thought, I can't believe this.
Do you ever consider other routes, or is there no choice? It's the only way you can go?
The answer, I guess the answer, continuing on from our earlier conversation, is that if I'm going using the standby method that I always do, Dulles is always going to be the option that I'm taking. There are other planes that exist in the world, but the standby route on United to where I want to get is always going to go through Dulles.
Great. It's time to let standby go.
Yeah.
You've outgrown it.
Yeah, you think so?
Mm-hmm.
I'll have to think about this. The only thing in Dulles that I was kind of interested to discover, because we talked about those tank truck AT-ATs that transport you from terminal to terminal.
Oh, yeah, they sound cool.
They do sound cool. I did find in Dulles, if you look in the right spots, you can see disused infrastructure from where those things used to connect into the terminals and where they now go into nothing. There are some doors that just open out into open space 20 feet over the ground. And I realized, I always just thought, what are these stupid doors that go to nowhere? And then I figured out last time, I go, oh, right, of course. These are disused docking points for transport at Dulles.
They're at loading bays.
So if you are at Dulles Airport and you see a door that could injure you severely if you walk through it, that is the old Dulles infrastructure. So you may be there right now. Go find them. It's like a fun scavenger hunt to do at the world's most terrible airport.
So let's talk about watches for a second.
Oh yeah, you want to talk watches?
Of course I do.
I know you do.
Have you seen this new watch that combines a cool Swiss watch and a Apple Watch?
Have I seen it? My whole Twitter feed has been filled with this dual-purpose watch from Hello Internet listeners.
I think people were pretty keen for us to talk about it.
That was definitely the impression that I got of anything that's happened in the past 3 weeks. This was overwhelmingly the thing that clearly people were dying for us to talk about was the Swiss watch stroke Apple Watch 2-in-1 watch. So we're doing it, people.
My Twitter feed lit up so hot, I thought a plane must have crashed. Anyway, so do you want to quickly describe it for... Yeah.
For the very few of you who listened to this podcast and didn't tweet us about this watch, it is a, if you think of a traditional link watch for a man, this was a watch that has a normal face on the front, a normal analog watch face. Hmm. And very cleverly, the links go around, and on the underside of the wrist, they made the connecting, the connecting slugs for the Apple Watch. So the bottom line is that you have a normal looking watch on your wrist, and on the underside of your wrist, very discreetly, I would imagine, you have the Apple Watch there. And I actually thought this was kind of a brilliant idea. I think it's ridiculously expensive. I was seeing people toss around some crazy numbers, but I thought the fundamental idea wasn't bad. And it was just, I'm not saying I would do it, Brady, but when we were talking last time about, oh, would you wear two watches, one on each wrist? Of course not. No, that's just dumb. It never occurred to me, two watches on one wrist. Well, now maybe there's something to this, but from your huge sigh, I presume you have other thoughts about this.
It's stupid. It's stupid.
Yeah. You think it's stupid?
Yeah, the Apple Watch tells the time. If you want to tell the, like, I think it's ridiculous. I don't know. I made my thoughts clear about it with one of my responding tweets, where I made my own version of it. Mm-hmm. That also includes a cheese grater, you know. If you want, like, I use cheese graters, and I think they're useful. Uh-huh. But I don't bolt one onto my watch.
Uh-huh. Yeah, that's the perfect analogy for the situation, Brady. Absolutely perfect.
Thank you. I thought you'd like that.
Yeah, I won't try to pick that apart in the slightest. I'm just going to try to get all the value out of that.
Yeah, okay. Good. I just think... It's silly. The whole...
I love your voice right now. It's like you're so frustrated you don't even know what to do.
Oh, no. I mean, well, it's not going to catch on anyway, so it doesn't matter, but...
It's not going to catch on because it's a fortune.
Yeah, but even if it was cheap, the whole point of... People don't get it. The people who are going to shun the Apple Watch and stick with a nice Swiss watch... like the classiness of a nice Swiss watch. Mm-hmm. It's not like they're thinking, oh, the Swiss watch has got a real utility for me, but I also want the utility of an Apple Watch, so let's bolt them together and have something that doesn't look quite as nice and classy but does both. Mm-hmm. It's like, it's a decision.
My thought on this is it lets each thing be the thing that it wants to be. You have
no. It doesn't. It's not. It does not. Great. It's not letting the Swiss watch be the thing the Swiss watch should be, because a good Swiss watch doesn't have some piece of modern electronic equipment hanging off its bum.
Listen, the Swiss watch is on top, taking the glory position that everybody can see it, and it looks really good. And then the Apple Watch is the workhorse on the other side where people are less likely to see it, but it can still provide all the functionality of tapping you on the wrist for notifications. And presumably it can still do the health monitoring stuff from that location of measuring your heartbeat and everything else. So I thought this is a good idea.
I don't think it's sufficiently discreet, but let's say it is sufficiently discreet. It still completely ignores the whole fact of tradition.
No, oh, well,
like it's the tradition of an old fashioned watch. People like to.
I mean, yeah, I can never argue against your position of we used to do things a different way and now we don't. I mean, yeah, you win that one.
Hmm.
We used to do things differently.
Okay, well now who's making a stupid argument?
I think my argument is perfectly reasonable here, and your argument is I like the way things used to be done. Don't ever change them.
Yeah, right.
One little thing about why this caught my attention right away is because when I actually first had my Apple Watch, I thought, you know, let me try to wear, you're gonna hate this. As soon as I say this, I just realized. But when I had my Apple Watch, I actually tried it for maybe a day, putting the face on the wrist, because I thought it feels like it's more comfortable, actually, if you're using the screen sometimes and pressing the buttons, to have the face on the wrist, on the bottom of the wrist, as opposed to the top of the wrist. So I actually tried wearing my watch the other way around, and I came to the conclusion that yes, it is more comfortable, but it does not outweigh how dumb it looks to wear your watch that way. So that's another reason why I felt pretty amenable to this double watch look with your traditional one on top and your other one on bottom.
I'm a bit surprised you like it, but I'm not entirely surprised, because the sort of person who likes an Apple Watch is different to me already. So I'm hardly going to be surprised that they like this thing, which I think is stupid as well.
Uh-huh. What are you wearing on your wrist right now? Don't you have a whole bunch of watches and a new watch, maybe? Is there a new watch in your life?
I am wearing my Speedmaster at the moment, but I do have a new watch.
Tell me about your new watch. Because I got a message from you from Morocco while I'm in Hawaii about something that had caught your eye in a local store.
No, it wasn't. It wasn't local.
Was it not? I wasn't paying any attention. I thought that junky store that you sent me a picture of that was horrifying with stuff everywhere is where you found this watch, like in a corner, in a box.
No, I was just shopping on the internet and just, I'd been coveting it for a while, and eventually I thought, I have to have it.
Oh, okay.
So I bought it online. Let me get it for you first, because it makes a lovely sound. Hang on.
Okay, you're going to go get that?
Oh.
Hello again, internet. Brady's just away, getting his watch from who knows where. I don't know why he's so against these Apple watches.
Why are you talking to them in my absence?
I
saw an Apple Watch today, Gray. Like, they're like hen's teeth for me. I was really surprised. I saw one out in the wild today.
Oh, yeah?
So, yeah. Hmm. So here's my new watch. Mm-hmm. Like the Speedmaster, it's a manual watch, so you have to wind it up. But this is actually noisier than the Speedmaster, so you can hear it wind up. You ready? This is it winding it up. You listening?
Oh, we're listening.
Isn't that a great noise?
That does sound very nice.
So there you go. I have a new watch. It is a Smith's watch. This is a Smith's Deluxe. And this is an old watch from, I think this one was 1954. This is one of the two types of watch that the Everest climbers used when they got to the top in 53.
Mm-hmm.
And there is much debate to be had, but apparently Edmund Hillary was wearing one of these when he got to the top. And Tenzing, I think, might have been wearing a Rolex. But because the expedition were using Rolexes and these Smith's watches. Smith's has gone out of business now. They don't exist anymore. It's an English watch, not a Swiss watch.
Mm.
And it's just a lovely old thing. And I just wanted to have it. And I got it.
It sounds very nice. It's I told you on Insta Message, it's not my aesthetic preference for watches, but it is still a good looking watch in the abstract. I'm noticing a bit of a theme with you for explorers watches. Is that fair to say?
That is fair to say. Let me just send you another picture of it that I took.
I have another question about this.
Go ahead.
So just a hypothetical here. But let's say the first man on Mars lands wearing an Apple Watch.
Mm-hmm.
Does that change your feeling about Apple Watches? Would you like them more?
Well, no, because that's not like it's not an old historic thing anymore. But in 50 years, I can imagine someone like me liking it.
But you wouldn't feel, oh, I have this whole collection of explorers' watches that I'm building up.
No.
And now I need an Apple Watch because someone landed on freaking Mars with an Apple Watch. No?
No, it would be a bit more commercial these days. But anyway, have a look at this picture.
Okay, I'm looking at this picture.
This is a picture I took last night of the new watch.
Oh. That's a good looking picture of that watch. It is old and beat up, but that's a great photo of it.
I think it does it more justice too. That is kind of what it looks like.
Yeah. That looks good.
It's smaller than the Speedmaster.
Yeah. Kind of tan gold looking with big numbers.
Here's a picture of it next to the Speedmaster. How many of these can I send before you just tell me to stop?
Not very many more. Not very many more at all. Because I have the poor listener in mind. who's
Oh, are we still recording? I just thought this was just...
who's now listening to a show called Brady Sends Me Pictures of His Watches, and I tell him they are nice. Yes, those are two very nice watches. I think I need picture of those two next to an Apple Watch for scale, though. I think that's what I need.
Well, you know how big the Speedmaster is. You've seen that.
I do.
I'm sorry. You say all these nice things about my watches, and I just keep telling you that I don't like the Apple Watch.
It's okay. I don't need you to like the Apple Watch. I just think your dislike of it is funny.
Mm-hmm. I was trying to think of something nice to say about it, and I couldn't think of anything.
And I wouldn't want it any other way, Brady. This episode of Hello Internet is brought to you by Harrys.com. High-quality razors and blades for a fraction of the price of the big razor brands. Harrys offers factory direct pricing at a fraction of the cost of what you probably normally pay. And you don't have to wait around for some guy to come unlock the anti-shoplifting case at your local pharmacy. These razors just show up at your house. The starter set is quite the deal. For $15, you get a razor, moisturizing cream, and 3 razor blades. When you need more blades, they're just $2 each or less. With Harry's, you get the convenience and ease of ordering online. You get high-quality blades, you get a great shave, excellent customer service, and it's all shipped right to your house from their factory in Germany. Those Germans, they make nice, high-quality things. So begin your journey with Harry's by trying their starter set with the handle, 3 blades, and shaving cream for just $15 shipped to your door. And when you use the promo code HI, you get $5 off your first purchase, which is 33% off their starter set. It's a pretty good deal. Once again, thanks to Harry's for supporting the show.
So let's talk about something YouTube related for a change.
All right, yeah. Well, wasn't this ostensibly a podcast about the fact that we're YouTubers like a year ago?
I know. So there's been a historic change at YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
They have done away with the view counters freezing at 301.
It has been, for as long as I have known YouTube anyway, they have always, if you have a popular video for the first, I mean, I remember when I was doing my very first videos, it would sometimes be for more than 24 hours that if you had a popular video, it would just say 300 or 301 views for a day. And you would have no idea how many views the video was actually getting. And the usual reason that I've heard from YouTube about why they paused it was because they were trying to check and make sure through their algorithms that all of the views were legitimate, that there wasn't somebody just running a server farm somewhere, reloading the page constantly to bump up the view numbers on a video. So they had to go to 300 and then they just stopped it, which was, I always thought was a really weird thing. Like, why didn't they just write below the video, new video in the space where the view counter was? Because it always led to arguments from people because you could see that a video, for example, was getting thousands of thumbs up and thumbs down, but still had 300 views. And so there was always an argument about how can these two things be true? And then somebody would have to lean in and explain what the situation was. I don't know why they had the views at all, why they didn't just write new video at the bottom. But you have been profiting from this very confusion for a couple of years now with your video on the phenomenon.
I know. I made a video explaining it, don't talk to me about much, but obviously you're uncomfortable with it for various reasons that you don't tell me why. But you're skeptical about the whole thing. But anyway.
What are you talking about?
I don't know. You just, whenever you talk about it, you're kind of a bit funny about it. Not my video, but just like the whole 300, 301 thing.
Am I?
It's 301. It's not 300. One of the main purposes of the whole video is to say why it's 301 uh-huh. and not 300, because 300 at least would have sort of seemed to have made sense in some arbitrary way, but 301 was just bizarre.
Mm-hmm.
But this was an error in itself, a coding, an out by one coding error.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was supposed to be 300, but someone mucked up with a greater than equals sign. Mm. So anyway, they've done away with it. They've decided they have the technology now to be testing for cheats in real time and not have to stop for a while and have a breath and have a little think about it. And
in all fairness to YouTube, this is something they have gotten better at over time, that I have noticed the videos have been updating faster and faster and faster with what the numbers are. Because I remember posting videos in the morning and staying up really late at night, hoping to be able to refresh and have some sense of how the video was doing, and then just having to go to sleep and see it in the next morning. And now they've gotten it down to on the order of hours, and obviously, currently, they're able to do it in real enough time. But I think the very first thing I did when I heard about this was I messaged you, I think, and said, oh, I'm really sorry about your 300 video, 301 video. That
see what is it with you? You've got an out by one error.
I do.
Gray's robot brain has an out by one error.
Yes, yeah, so I thought, oh, you know, your video that was going to perpetually make advertising revenue for you is now done. But you told me that YouTube has made a special dispensation for your video. Is that right?
I know the view counters freezing on 301 would never happen again on YouTube,
mm-hmm.
except for on one video.
Mm-hmm.
My video.
I like that someone has hard-coded this into the YouTube platform, that video by Brady will always display 301 as the view count.
I was a bit funny about it at first because that video has been watched about 3.5 million times, which is quite a few views for a mm-hmm. YouTube video, mm-hmm. for me anyway. So I was a bit sad to be losing a 3.5 million video view count from my CV. But the more I think about it, the more I think it's better this way.
Yeah, knowing that someone at YouTube took the time to special code something for just your video, that's way better than having the view counter there. The only other video that I'm pretty sure has the same thing is there is a Futurama clip of the alien species that feels perfectly neutral about everything. And there's just a quick 2-second clip of someone saying, I have no opinions on this matter. Or no, they say something like, I don't feel strongly about this one way or the other.
Yeah.
And it must be hard coded that the number of thumbs up and thumbs down on that video is always exactly equal.
All right. It's not one of these things where the community does it together. Like,
it's always exact. So I have to assume that someone has hard coded that in.
Yeah,
because people link to that on Reddit a bunch, and I have never seen it with even being off by one.
Okay,
I may be wrong, but I'd be curious to know if people can try to make it off by one. But I think
but the numbers do change. It's not the same numbers.
The numbers go up, but the number of thumbs up and thumbs down is always different. It's always exactly the same.
That's cool.
Yes, that's the only other one I know of that's like that.
All right.
So it's a coup for you.
A coup for me, hey?
Yeah, but no one's going to link that video anymore because there's going to be no more confusion. So it is passed into history.
Maybe it'll be like that Reddit thing you said, though, with the thumbs. Maybe, you know, every 6 months or so, someone on Reddit will notice and say, oh, look, this one's still stuck on 301.
Mm-hmm. Maybe.
Or maybe not. Maybe
probably
not.
I don't think so, no.
No. Oh, well. Never mind. Never times mind. Change, don't they?
Yeah.
Times change. We all go out and buy silly double-sided watches and...
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's how that works.
They've unintegrated Google Plus, have they, from YouTube as well? Like they're changing something there? Do you know anything about that?
I have been off the internet for this whole travel time, essentially. So I only know the barest of things from Twitter, but that, yes, Google Plus and YouTube are being unintegrated or not requiring integration. And I don't understand at all how this is going to work. I don't get the whole thing, but the bottom line is that it seems like Google is finally admitting in some small way that Google Plus is the total failure that it is, and that nobody likes it. Not a single person on the face of the earth likes Google Plus. And so maybe they're going to make it go away. And I still, like, I only have 3 YouTube channels that I manage. I'm nowhere near like you with dozens. And I still can't figure out what the heck I'm supposed to do with Google Plus pages managing other things.
I have
contacted people at Google to be like, can you give me a diagram? Like what is the structure supposed to look like with these Google Plus pages? And I was like, I have no idea. Every once in a while, when I log into YouTube, I have a small heart attack because it looks, I look on the corner, it says CGP Gray and I'm logged in and I go to click on my videos and there's nothing there. and every time I go, right, because my whole livelihood has just been thrown into doubt. And it's like, oh, right, of course, I have some bizarre duplicate Google Plus page that I can't get rid of because I don't even know why, that I don't use for anything.
The problem is, they'll get rid of it. They'll say it was stupid and they'll claw back from it.
Right.
But because I started all these channels and did all these things when Google Plus was like at its height of being forced upon us all,
right,
I'm going to be stuck with these 19,000 different multiple layered logins for the rest of my life.
Yeah.
And disentangling it is impossible.
Yeah. My concern as well is, okay, great. No more Google Plus and YouTube. Thumbs up. But am I now going to be stuck with 2 layers of legacy on my YouTube account? Because I have some legacy stuff because I set up stuff before Google Plus that they never were able to get rid of when they integrated. And now that they're undoing it, it's like, oh, great. Can we just, like, what was so bad about making an account on YouTube? Like, I never understood. Well, I mean, I kind of know why they wanted to have Google Plus happen, but it was just a very frustrating situation. I'm glad it's gone. Nobody liked Google Plus. Nobody will miss Google Plus.
I tell you what, if someone following sort of YouTube news saw, oh, there's a new player and 301 and Google Plus, I'm going to listen to Hello Internet because those two YouTube experts are going to have some really interesting insights. And they've tuned in and it's just you and I talking about words that taste like raspberry yogurt.
Yeah. I do have one more piece of YouTube news while we're doing a little bit of a YouTube segment here.
Yep.
Did you see the thing about their new diamond button?
I did.
Yeah. So
I did.
YouTube now has a new button.
This is like a trophy that gets sent out. This is a trophy that gets sent out to people, by the way. It's not like a button that appears on your screen.
It's a physical trophy that junks up your house is what they send out to you. And my understanding from memory is that it is for 10 million subscribers. They send you the diamond button, which is a level above, right? Because it's silver for 100,000, gold for 1 million. And diamond for 10 million.
It's interesting. I wonder, because subscribers are becoming a less important metric, I think, for the importance of a YouTube channel. It feels that way. So it's interesting they're still sort of upping the ante and they're making that the thing to look at and not view counts and things like that. So, but anyway.
I agree with you that it is interesting. There's 2 things about this button that I think are interesting. One is precisely what you said, that YouTube still wants to have some reward and some focus on building your subscriber base, which is just in the world of what messages are companies sending out. I think that's an interesting message. And second, because from my perspective, the YouTube subscriber numbers are fiddled with, and they're so determined by precisely how YouTube changes algorithms and sets things up. I almost think that the 10 million number, my first thought was that seems low, because it seems like almost a low number to have the next big crossover point be. I mean, I know they're just going by orders of 10 here, but there's some YouTube channels with just ungodly numbers of subscribers. But I am also aware that the subscriber number used to be the number one thing that I looked at, and I judged my whole career based on the subscriber number. And I remember when I was debating leaving my full-time teaching, I had a spreadsheet with a number of subscribers that I wanted to hit where I thought YouTube would be viable as a career. And so I was just so focused on subscriber numbers. And I'm now aware that because of some changes at YouTube, I never think about subscriber numbers. I don't promote people to subscribe to the channel. It's just not a number that crosses my mind anymore. I think much more in terms of subscribers to my email list and also views on a video. But I'm really aware of the subscriber number just having completely slipped from my mind in terms of important metrics that I need to track.
I agree. It used to be something actually, just today, someone I'm friends with passed 500,000 subscribers,
mm-hmm.
and they tweeted about it, mm-hmm. and that made me think, oh, 60 Symbols is getting close to 500,000 as well. I'm going to have a look.
Mm-hmm.
And I went and looked, and it had passed 500,000 the day before,
mm-hmm.
yesterday as we record, and I didn't even know. Like, I hadn't looked at the number for so long that I didn't even know.
Right.
And that would have been something in the old days that, you know, you make a video about and song and dance, and I didn't even know it had happened.
You'd be aware of it weeks ahead of time, trying to plan something for exactly launch, like the Mile of Pi video, which was for the million subscribers on Numberphile. Yeah. Like, you orchestrated a whole team of people to pull off a big stunt for a million for Numberphile. Yeah. And yeah, it's... I think this is YouTube.
I'd still do it for a million. I'd still do it for a million on the other channels as well, because a million is such a nice number. But
a million is a nice number. It's an impressive sounding number. But I know from speaking to other people that they have said even now, crossing the million number feels a bit like not like a huge victory, even a slightly hollow victory, because of the way YouTube does some of the subscriber stuff. Like, it's just it just doesn't feel the same like it used to be.
I agree.
Anyway, I just thought it was interesting to see that YouTube still wants people to focus on that number, but I think YouTube's other actions conflict with that. You're going to get a diamond button? What's your closest to the diamond? Is it Numberphile?
Oh, Numberphile, yeah. I'm miles away from that.
Yeah. You can put the diamond button above your 5 silver buttons.
I'll probably have 30 silver buttons before I get to a diamond button.
What you can have in your office is a big pyramid, a huge number of silver buttons, a smaller row of gold buttons, and at the top, a diamond button.
Yeah.
That's what you'll have, is a little pyramid in your office.
If I get to 10 million, I'll certainly ask for one.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Just because I want to see what they look like.
Of course. You can see what they look like on the video. Did you not watch the video?
No, everything looks different in real life.
Yeah. And I also don't think it's made out of real diamond. It's disappointing.
No.
It does. It's really big. Like, all of their trophies are comically, awkwardly huge.
The silver buttons aren't comically big.
Oh, really? I've never seen one in real life.
I'm trying to think. They're smaller than like an IMAX screen.
Mm-hmm. Do you still have those above your fireplace?
No, they're in boxes in another room.
Oh, okay.
I don't think I'm going to put them up. And obviously my gold button's in America, so I haven't got that either. Yeah, and you know where the gold button is.
I do know where the gold button is.
Say it. I want to hear you say it.
It's at the spiritual home of Numberphile.
That's right. Which is where, though?
The Mathematical Research Institute. In San Francisco?
Mathematical Science Sciences Research Institute, yes. MSRI.
MSRI.
But I just like hearing you say it's spiritual home of Numberphile.
Yeah? Does that taste like raspberries for you?
It does. It tastes like. It is a bit. It's certainly berry-like. So there's all these things still we haven't talked about.
Okay, listen, let's just be clear here. We can't possibly talk about all of the things that are in our notes here. We just have a bazillion things.
Yeah.
We've already been recording for a long time. Granted,
a
huge section of this was just nonsense.
I'm trying to think, what section of it wasn't nonsense?
what's catching your eye?
I don't think you'll want to talk about the lion.
What lion?
The killing of the lion.
I do not know this.
Oh, man. It's like been one of the biggest stories of the last couple of weeks.
Do you want to tell me about it? What is it? Someone killed a lion?
Yeah, basically. It was this American dentist
mm-hmm.
who's like into trophy hunting.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, one of these guys who pays big money to go to Africa and kill an animal.
Right.
And have his picture taken with it.
Yeah, so they can feel big.
Basically. And I'm sure he would have gone on quite happily in obscurity doing this for the rest of his days. Except he went to Zimbabwe and the lion that he shot with his like his minders that set it up for him ended up being this famous celebrity lion that everyone loves in the national park and had an Oxford University tracking device on it and stuff. So it became this huge story that the lion got shot and then he got revealed as the guy who shot it.
Wait, hold on. I am so confused already by this story. Let's back up for a second.
Okay.
Okay. First of all, number one, is it legal to go hunt lions in Africa? Like, is this a thing you can legally do?
Yes.
We have enough lions that this is not a problem?
Well, that's that. The answer to that question isn't necessarily yes.
Okay.
But it is legal if it's done in certain ways.
Okay,
but
so this is not like rhino hunting, right? Where there's no legal place you can pay money to shoot a rhino.
There are legal places you can hunt lions, and Zimbabwe is one of them. Mm-hmm. But it turns out this was not done legally.
Right, because sounds like they were in some national park.
They were, well, apparently they lured it out of the national park and shot it outside the national park, but they lured it out. Mm-hmm. Basically, they put like a dead carcass on the back of a car, mm-hmm. and then the lion comes along and says, oh, that looks good.
They're walking the lion into this guy's sights. These people are basically the Sherpas of the hunting world.
And then this big brave dentist used a crossbow, I believe, to shoot this lion that was just sniffing along for some food.
Right.
That by the by, this guy then got exposed as the guy who did it mm-hmm. and has become like the most hated man in America.
Right.
And he's gone into hiding and people are protesting outside his dental surgery and mm-hmm. the people in Africa have been taken to court and there's talks about extraditing this guy. And it's been this whole big palaver. It's a really interesting story, which I was going to ask you what you thought about, but as I'm the one telling you about it.
As this is probably, literally the first time I'm hearing about it.
Yeah, there's probably not a great deal for me to ask you. I mean, you know me, right? I don't like internet witch hunts and lynch mobs. And this guy has been like lynch mobbed mm-hmm. in multiple different ways. Mm-hmm. And yet, you also know I really love animals. Mm-hmm. And I'm really, really struggling to muster up any sympathy for this guy. Because, and all these other pictures have now come out of him shooting other animals all around the world. You know, he's killed every lovely animal you can think of. Mm-hmm. And I don't know. I just think this trophy hunting. Like, I don't mind people hunting. You know, there are sometimes there are good reasons for hunting. But just killing a lion so you can say you killed a lion. And all you're doing is just like, it's just walking into a clearing. And you're just getting an easy shot anyway. It's not like he got thrown into a cage with the lion and wrestled it to the ground and overcame it. So it's not even like he did. That would be bad too. But at least he would be like, he would have done an amazing thing to have gotten his lion head.
Exactly.
This guy didn't even do an amazing thing.
Yeah. That's always my feeling about this kind of hunting is you go to an exotic location to kill an exotic animal. I always feel like I am not impressed unless you did it with your bare hands. If you did it with your bare hands, you know what? You still shouldn't have killed that thing, but at least I'm impressed. Whereas when you're, you know, you have minders setting it up for you, you're using a ranged weapon. I feel like I couldn't be more unimpressed with what you have done. And you haven't done a good thing. There's no overpopulation problem. Nah. It's just all around thumbs down.
It reminds me of one of my favorite Far Side comics. Which is the, you know, Far Side by Gary Larson.
Oh, of course. Yeah.
And it's the one where there's the grizzly bear, like really cute grizzly bears, just have it lapping up some water from a little pond. And there's a hunter behind a bush that basically shoots it in the back. And then it like falls over dead, all sad, while it was drinking water. Uh-huh. And then it cuts to the next shot and it's him in his den with the stuffed bear in like this angry pose, like it was attacking when he shot it. So.
Yeah, that's about right.
Yeah. But so anyway, this modern ability we have to sort of publicly shame and lynch someone, I don't mm-hmm. always like, but this guy's on the, I'm, as I said, I'm struggling to feel sorry for this guy.
Yeah. I'm with you on the lynch mobs. On the last Audible ad that I did, I recommended that book, So You Have Been Publicly Shamed by Ron Johnson, who's an author in London, I believe, which is, I think, everybody who spends any time on the internet should read that book. It's a really interesting book about how these lynch mobs form. And I am very sympathetic to people saying dumb things or wandering into situations and then the internet just vastly overreacts to what's going on. Like, I think those are complicated situations in which it's important to try and think about other people in the full spectrum of their complexity. But I'm going to say, at least from the version of this that you have told me, I don't have the same kind of, ooh, let's be cautious. Oh, you know, what about the person feeling in this story? Because it's someone who has gone way out of their way with a lot of effort to do a thing that is of no value to anybody. So that's why I feel like, you know, if there's some kind of big public reaction to it, okay, it may be out of proportion, but I'm also having a hard time caring about a person who does that.
Because you mentioned audiobooks, mm-hmm. Let me have one more little quick topic.
Okay.
Because this has been on my mind a lot, and I wanted to ask you about it, because mm-hmm. I know you're a bit of an audiobook aficionado.
Mm-hmm.
I don't listen to a lot of fiction audiobooks,
mm-hmm.
but I have been just lately. And I want to talk to you about the people who read them, the voice people who do audiobooks, because mm-hmm. I know you pay attention to this.
Mm-hmm.
This book I'm listening to, it's a Stephen King book. It's the one about the JFK assassination thing. What's it called? I always get, because it's in American date format, I always get the name wrong.
I'm leaning around the microphone. I'm literally in a room where I can see it on the wall right now. It's in my parents' book collection.
Yeah.
Stephen King, it is 11/22/63.
So there you go. I recommended it in the last Audible ad, I think.
Mm-hmm.
It has like a cast of characters of all types.
Mm-hmm.
Men, women, people with different accents, people of different races, all sorts. And the guy reading it, whose name I don't know, puts on voices for all the different characters.
Mm-hmm.
I assume this is normal in audiobooks to sort of have a voice for different characters.
Yep.
And
yep. Particularly in fiction.
Yes. Most of the time, he's quite good. He's mm-hmm. quite good. Does quite a good New England accent, which he has to do quite a lot. He has to do a few famous people, like he had to do JFK, and I think he did him quite well.
Ooh, that's got to be hard, though.
It was all right. It was all right. Anyway, that's by the by. But the thing is, there's also, like, I'm not going to do any spoilers, but I don't think it's spoiling to say there's a romance in the book, and there's a woman who mm-hmm. a guy has a romance with.
Mm-hmm.
And it turns out, this seems like a trivial fact, but I think it's contributing to my problem. It mm-hmm. turns out the woman he has this relationship with is quite tall. Mm-hmm. It's just part of the story that she's quite a tall woman. Anyway, this guy voices the woman, and I have real problems with it because mm-hmm. it's supposed to be romantic and you're supposed to understand the chemistry between them and feel the love and the romance and be engaged in this plot line of this romance. But it just sounds like a man doing a woman's voice. And because she's tall, it makes it even harder for me. I just imagine the character as a man dressed up as a woman. And it makes the whole love story completely unbelievable to me. Mm-hmm. I cannot engage with the love story because I'm imagining him in bed with or kissing or having these deep and meaningful conversations between my main character
mm-hmm.
and this like man dressed as a woman with a big Adam's apple and a dodgy wig and all sorts. And it's really detracting from the book slightly for me. So for that aspect of the book, I'm still really engaged in it and I'm actually going to mm-hmm. finish it because I'm really enjoying it and it's epically long, so it must be good. But I'm just wondering where you stand on that. How do you feel about these people putting on voices? Because it can make or break an audiobook, I imagine.
Yeah, without a doubt, it can make or break an audiobook, especially fiction, how well someone does the voices. And the situation that you are talking about is something I've run across a bunch. And I was just, as you were talking, I was trying to think about what my brain does. And I realized, oh, I know what happens here. It's when you have a male narrator who has to do a woman's voice. And yeah. every male narrator, I don't know how to describe it, but they all do the same thing when they're doing a woman's voice, which is, I'm going to say just be, they're making their voice breathier and slightly, but not really high-pitched.
Like all kind of Gone with the Wind, oh, Rhett Butler sort of, oh, be still my beating heart.
Yeah, that kind of thing. And I guess the key point that I'm trying to make here is, for example, you mentioned that in this book in particular, someone is trying to do JFK. Like a man trying to do JFK as the narrator will try to, if not sound like JFK, certainly capture something about the way JFK speaks. But male narrators doing women's voices, they do this same thing, which is not remotely sounding like a woman. No woman sounds like the way male narrators make a woman sound when they read a book.
Yeah.
And I think I never really thought about it, but whenever I listen to an audiobook that has this happen, the first time the male narrator does a female voice, I feel uncomfortable. It's like, oh God, here we go. But very quickly, my brain just accepts and says, well, we're just going to pretend that this is what this sounds like.
Yeah, you suspend disbelief.
I always think of when I watch the old Twilight Zone episodes, which I really like. They have terrible special effects because it was made in the 1950s with absolutely no money. The special effects are awful, but they're so awful every time I'm watching the Twilight Zone, I'm aware that my brain treats it like it's a stage play, that there's a whole different level of expectation for how good the special effects are supposed to be. And on a stage play, if someone comes on with a ridiculous fake eye in the middle of their head or fake arms or antennas sticking out their heads, you just think, well, of course it's not going to look real because it's a stage play. And you just kind of go along with it. And so I think without even having really consciously thought about it before, I go along with the male audiobook narrators doing this thing that sounds nothing like a woman, almost because they sound so different from a woman that it's like, oh, well, we have to go to a whole different level of suspending disbelief to make this work. And it somehow is fine in my mind.
I was going to say to you, what's the solution like? But you don't need a solution because of what you just said. But I wonder, you know, I guess you can't, can a man be better at sounding like a woman? I don't know, but do you not do it? Do you have a separate narrator?
There's two possible solutions. The first of which is that a man could attempt better to mimic the actual sounds of a woman, like the way a woman's voice sounds. But I would bet there's a reason that I've never heard a male narrator do that, because you probably run into an uncanny valley situation where even if you are quite good at actually imitating a woman's voice, you're not perfect. And it just sounds even worse,
right?
Because then again, your level of expectation is higher. And so the failure becomes more stark than if it's just, oh, listen to me, this is a woman's voice, right? Which it isn't, but we're all just going to pretend that it is.
Yeah.
So that's one option. The second option is to try to bring in different narrators, bring in an actual woman to do the woman's dialogue.
Yeah.
And this is a problem with books where when I'm listening to fiction, very, very rarely, I can actually only think of one example, do fiction books sound better when you have a cast doing them? Because usually I actually just find it very disruptive somehow, because you're in the mode of someone's reading you a book and then they switch over to here is a character speaking and we have brought in an actor to do this character. And suddenly it's like, oh, whoa, right. I'm not actually being read a book by somebody.
Yeah.
There's a bunch of people sitting in a room around microphones. And I find it very disturbing when that happens.
I can imagine it would take you out of the moment quite a lot.
Yeah, it's every time it's disturbing when you switch to someone and you're not expecting it. And I'll say that just before people ask, the only example that I can think of off the top of my head that is really good is the His Dark Materials series by Philip Pullman. They did a version of that with a full cast. And that is a magnificent series of audiobooks to listen to with the full cast. But I think it's in no small part because of the structure of the way the story works, that every person in the story has a little animal that they're always talking to. Because there's constant dialogue, there's never ever a long section where the narrator is talking to you and you can slip into that mode of, oh, I'm being read a story. You're always having a dialogue between two characters. And since it happens all the time, I think you can treat that as a different mode. So I think there is really no solution to this. I don't like casts of characters in books normally. And I think trying to do a more convincing impression can actually possibly be worse.
I tell you what, are Audible sponsoring this episode?
I don't know if Audible sponsoring this episode. Let's see.
Because they've done well today. I want to go and download his Dark Materials after this.
Yeah. Are you going to be mad if they're not sponsoring it? How are you going to feel if they're not sponsoring it?
Well, I don't mind. As long as people still use our code or URL.
There is no Audible sponsor for this one. Of course, the listeners already know that. We don't know because this is at the very end. They already know that our sponsors were Harry's Backblaze and Hover. Thanks, guys.
Okay.
But
there you go.
Not Audible this time. So you should listen to his Dark Materials. It's very good.
Yeah. And do use our Audible link, even though they didn't sponsor the episode. I'm sure they'll sponsor us again, so they can have a little bit of free love there.
Yeah. Yeah, they sponsor us in the future, so yeah, tiny bit of free love.
All right.
I have one thing, Brady. You might want to not do this. I'll just throw this in, but I have a potential homework suggestion if you want to do this.
Go on.
My homework suggestion. And I know I can feel reasonably comfortable suggesting this because I know you have already done the homework. I know you don't like doing the homework. Yeah. Would be The Martian. I don't
know. The book.
Yes, the book. I don't know the author of that book.
But Andy Weir.
There we go. I recently read this and I thought, not a huge discussion, but I thought we could have a little bit of a discussion on The Martian next time if you wanted. And so I thought I would give people a heads up this time if they want to read the book between now and who knows when the next Hello Internet comes out.
Okay. Well, that's good. I have read it, so fine. I've done my homework.
So if I can pick topics where you've already done your homework, you're much more amenable to homework. Is that the lesson that I should take from this?
That is the way forward. Did you read it in text or did you audiobook it?
I read it on the airplane is where I read it. I read it on one of my flights.
Oh, do you know what we didn't talk about?
What?
I just want to quickly mention this just in case.
Uh-huh.
Lots of people have been messaging me about cricket. Obviously, there's this big cricket series happening at the moment between Australia and England, which means a lot to Australian and English people.
Right.
And as of today, for the record, England won the series and have very convincingly and have, you know, humiliated my Australian team, which is always terrible. But anyway, that's sport.
I'm sorry, Brady.
Yes. But amazingly, Gray had semi-agreed. Although I was still a little bit in doubt, but he pretty much agreed to come to a day of the cricket with me.
I had totally agreed to this, Brady. There was no doubt about the only doubt about this was in your mind.
No, because I think you knew you weren't going to make it back. But anyway, this is by the by. Gray had agreed.
It's not by the by. You just want to blow past this and feel separate. I'm putting it on the record now. I want to go to a cricket game with you.
Yes,
Brady.
You do.
Right?
So anyway,
you have a fun day out, and I want to do this.
It's happening. This is why I'm bringing it up, Gray. Let me finish.
Okay.
I have in my hand, actually, our tickets for the cricket. We were going to go to the cricket tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
Today, as I said, because it's just gone midnight. Today, Sunday, the 9th of August. I've got two tickets for us here to sit in the Radcliffe lower stand together. We were going to be in row J, seats 102 and 103.
Uh-huh.
But because Australia lost so convincingly, this game that was supposed to last 5 days only lasted 2 and a little bit days.
Mm-hmm.
So
this game isn't even happening. That's the understanding.
So not only can Gray not come because he got stuck in America because of his standby flights, but even if he hadn't got stuck in America, we wouldn't have been going to the cricket tomorrow because the cricket's not on. So having finally got Gray to agree to come to the cricket, two things conspired against us. And so Gray definitely can't come.
Mm-hmm.
Both of which were complete and utter deal breakers.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if Gray happens to get this podcast up quickly enough and you happen to have two tickets to the fifth test match at the Oval in London, so very easy for Gray, and you want to make them available to your old pals, Brady and Gray, so I can take him to that cricket match, drop me an email. Preferably, we would prefer corporate hospitality, a box, food, drink, all that sort of thing.
What are you signing? When is this? What are you signing me up for? I don't even know. When is this thing? What are you talking about?
Well, the final match between Australia and England, which is now a dead rubber because Australia have lost the series, but they still play it.
Dead rubber. Okay.
A game that means nothing because the series can't be won. England lead the series 3-1.
But they still make them do it. Okay.
They still, in America, they don't play, but in other sports, they quite often will still play.
Okay.
It starts on the 20th of August. So you got ages.
Okay. 20th of August. Almost certainly I'll be back. If I'm not back, it's been a long time. But almost certainly I'll be back by the 20th of August.
It's sold out, though. The game, like normal tickets are sold out. But
right, but you're hoping that among the surgeons, mice and humans and people on cruise boats and Air Force One assistants and parachutists and everything else.
What I'm really hoping for is a really, really rich accountant who has a corporate box.
Right.
Who calls up and says, oh, yeah, we've got champagne and caviar and in our air-conditioned suite and you can come up and watch the cricket. And
that does sound pretty good. That sounds pretty good. If you are a wealthy accountant, we can just piggyback off of like bums, I guess.
Yeah.
and join your sports box that's up high.
Sports box, yeah.
That sounds pretty good.
And watch the cricketers whack that shuttlecock all around the racket field.
It sounds great.
Yeah. but if not, we'll just go to another cricket game another time.
Yeah. Someday I will go to a cricket game with you. There's no doubt about that. The other question
is what to do with these tickets. I'm in a bit of a fundraising for charity mode at the moment for various reasons. And I'm thinking, two tickets for Brady and Gray to go to the cricket together to watch the Ashes. That never happened because Australia lost the Ashes and broke my heart. Broke my heart. I think there are English cricket fans that would get some pleasure from having these signed by us.
I was going to say, you need to sign one and I sign the other one.
Yeah, and you need to sign it like along the lines of, dear Brady, I'm sorry the Australian cricketers lost the Ashes.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. I'll sign that.
Yeah. I think we could probably raise more money for cancer research and hospice care.
Okay.
Doing that than I would get from sending these tickets back.
Yeah. You want to put these up on eBay for hospice stroke cancer research charity fundraising?
I'm thinking. And like, so any cricket fans who, because I know cricket fans get great pleasure from my pain. This is a chance to own it forever.
Oh, I see. So you're thinking this is an even better thing for English cricket fans. I get it.
It's the ultimate piece of sports memorabilia, a cricket ticket signed by a guy who knows absolutely nothing about cricket and a guy who loves Australia, but this was his team losing. So
I feel like you have dragged me on board this crazy train of yours with all of these auctions, because every time you have one of these auctions, I think no one's going to buy this thing, but you end up, you know, sending stuff to my house to sign the Getting Things Done book and some other stuff. And I was like, I can't believe these are always successful. And so now I feel like I've been pulled into your reality distortion matrix here and thinking, yeah, these totally worthless tickets, maybe we can raise some money for charity.
I think a cricket ticket signed by CTP Grey, like, I see value in that. And it's kind of like this, like, they're kind of like these cursed tickets now because
No, they're not cursed. Don't say
Let
that.
Me tell you why they're cursed.
No, they're not cursed. You're reducing the value if you'd say that they're cursed. It's like, you're putting up a monkey's paw for auction now.
No, I'm increasing the value because they're triply cursed because this was the test match where Australia lost the Ashes.
Uh-huh.
This was the day you were supposed to come to that you didn't come to because the test was over.
Right.
And it was the day you didn't come to because of your stupid cheapo standby tickets.
Uh-huh. Got it.
So.
Okay. So we're all in. If you want triply cursed cricket tickets signed by us, link in the description.
Yeah, right. I might. Yeah, or if the link's not in the description because I haven't got my act together in time, then just like follow us on social media stuff, and you know how the internet works.
Brilliant ending.
I like to end on a high, you know. I'm pretty professional these days.
All right, you want to stop it there?
hang on. No, what? One last thing. You listening?
Okay.
You listening?
Man, I literally had my mouse hovering above
Gray,
the stop button here.
Gray, shh, you listening?
Okay.
Sounds like a cricket, doesn't it? Like a grasshopper cricket.
I'm stopping this now. Oh, hey, actually, one little thing here.
Hmm.
Do you want to talk about our weekly weigh-ins? Because we forgot it last time, and people will be mad if we forget it this time.
I haven't done it.
Okay.